Thank you, sir, for having me in your IC, in your session. And I'll now cover the cases of esotropia. It's going to be entirely case-based, as was said. So we begin with the first case, a case of infantile esotropia. This is what the child looks like. He's come to us with a large-angle squint, typically presenting around 4 to 6 months of age. It's not something that they're born with. It's not a congenital esotropia. It's an infantile esotropia, as the name suggests. And this esotropia is a large angle. It is usually not affected. It's not an accommodative esotropia. It's not affected by accommodation, and that we'll come to in some while. It's a stable angle. There is usually a free alternation of the eyes. There is usually good vision in both the eyes. And there could be associations along with this, like oblique overactions here. We see there are inferior oblique overactions, and the eye is going up, further up, when you're looking in the tertiary gaze, that is in this case the dextro-elevative gaze, and in this case the levo-elevation gaze. So oblique overactions are known. There could be an associated nystagmus, there could be an associated DVD, and about at least from a third to about three-fourths the patients would have a nystagmus, a DVD, and an oblique overactions respectively. And in these cases, the treatment is first to do a cycloplegic refraction, and the cycloplegia of choice that we use is atropine, and we give eye ointment atropine 3 times a day for 3 days, and then on the 4th day the refraction is done. And that's the gold standard, because that gives us maximum cycloplegia. And after that, after the correction with the glasses, whatever deviation is left, that is the deviation that's operated. If there is amblyopia in any case, then an occlusion therapy is done, and we try to correct the amblyopia before doing the squint surgery. And the surgical management, like all infantile esotropes, will require a surgical procedure. When do we do it? 4 to 6 months of age. That, you know, we're now doing it earlier and earlier and earlier. The thought was to do it a little later, but now 4 to 6 months is, I think, what is established, and you must do it. And you must do a symmetrizing surgery. Usually we would think of operating both the eyes depending on the angle, and the surgery should not induce any incompetence, and you must always tackle any associated obliques, nystagmus or DVD, along with that. The next case that we'll come to is a refractive normo-accommodative esotropia. This is a child who has had an esotropia. Typically now these children are a little bigger. And, you know, you're going to have this after the 2 to 4 years of age once they start accommodation. And here, if you give them glasses, they correct their esotropia. So the esotropia here is for both distance and near, and it gets corrected with the glasses completely. And these patients, they don't need surgery, and you need to look at their glasses from time to time, you know, as they follow up with you. And this is a typical normo-accommodative esotropia. Now, there's something which is like a hyper-accommodative esotropia, and this is a refractive hyper-accommodative means that the person has a deviation for distance and esodeviation. There's an increased esodeviation for near, and if you give glasses, then the deviation for distance and near both will reduce, but there still continues to be a deviation for near if he's looking only through the distance segment of the glasses. So these are the people, they need a bifocal set of glasses, and if they see through the near segment here, and then that deviation disappears altogether. So this is a refractive hyper-accommodative type of an esotropia. So here it's important, that's why it's very important for us always to measure the distance deviation, the near deviation, with glasses, without glasses. All these diagnoses come from that, and obviously you have to do a good cycloplegic refraction in these patients before you come to the diagnosis. And that's what this is essentially summarizing. And what happens is that in these, and there's a partially, if there is a surgery that needs to be done, it has to be done again for the non-dynamic or the static portion of the esotropia that remains after you've given the correction, which is the bifocal correction. So we would often operate for a distance primary position, correct any obliques if there was an overaction, and then for near, they would continue to use bifocal glasses because the near eso was more than the distance eso. The next case that we'll come to is a non-refractive or a convergence excess esotropia where there's only an eso for distance, for near, not an eso for distance. And here the idea is just to give glasses for near, and that will correct it. So you can give a zero if there's no refractive error for distance with just a near add. The next case that we'll come across is the partially accommodative esotropia. This is a case where you've given the person who's come to you, a child who's come to you with an esotropia, you've given a proper cycloplegic correction. There still continues to be an esotropia. So now what you've left is an esotropia after the proper optical correction. And then you do a surgery. But after surgery also, if supposing you don't wear the glasses, they'll continue to have an eso. So the actual treatment would be glasses plus a surgical correction. So this is what you want to achieve. So remember, in these cases, first the glasses, whatever is left after the glasses of squint needs to be operated, and then they need to continue wearing the glasses and even after having the surgery done. And that's something that you must tell the parents, the guardians, the patient, that this is necessary, this is required for you. So that is the case of a partially accommodative esotropia. So I've basically covered the basic types of common types of esotropias that you can